Dinosaur survival games are a very young subgenre in the gaming industry. For the past 7 years, a very small order of games broke the mold of the traditional survival genre and created an experience that we cannot find anywhere else. These very niche games formed a very small but religiously dedicated community, with many of us easily playing them for hundreds or even thousands of hours. Currently, there are dozens of titles under this subgenre, being The Isle, Path of Titans, and Beast of Bermuda the most popular of the bunch. But even when we analyze most of them, there's always an aspect of the game that is heavily flawed. Now, of course, no game is perfect. There will be always a part of the gameplay experience that will be underwhelming, lacking, unbalanced, or just unfinished. However, even though the community played these games for an extraordinary amount of time, the level of disappointment is strangely high. Every time any of these titles are mentioned, the majority of responses are lukewarm, lackluster, or straight up anger and dissatisfaction. And the situation is even worse whenever someone outside of the community experiences any of these games for the first time. They are categorized as tech demos, empty games, walking simulators, and the thing is, as hard as it is to admit it, they are not wrong. Even going as close as the original traditional survival games like Ark, Rust, Minecraft, and Valheim, all of them are much more feature complete, possess more and more intricate mechanics, and most importantly, they all have a complete gameplay loop. But why is this subgenre like this? Why are the games that we love so much so deep into development hell and filled with bad design choices or lack of content? Are dinosaur games difficult to create in comparison to other genres? No, on the contrary, they require way less features or assets to create a simple but enjoyable experience. But what exactly do we need to make a dinosaur survival game work? What are the components necessary to form actual, full, complete, and engaging gameplay? First, we need to understand what makes this genre unique compared to everything else. In the gaming industry, you have probably heard the term MVP being tossed around. MVP stands for Minimal Viable Product, a very common method used in game development where a game concept is made as small and as empty as possible. No features, no assets, no sound, no mechanics. Just the most basic version of the game's main idea. The reason behind this practice is to determine if the core concept is fun or engaging despite its simplicity. In case some aspects of the prototype aren't as enjoyable or don't synergize with the rest of the game, this is the best time to work on it and change it. If your idea is fun even by just using squares on an empty map, then you have a good MVP in your hands. Keep in mind that the results of this exercise aren't black and white. If an idea isn't fun in its super simplistic form, doesn't necessarily mean it's doomed to fail or it's unfeasible. But smaller MVPs usually are easier to be made and require a lot less time and resources during development. Once you find the minimal viable product of your game, whatever aspect is part of it, those are your core game features. The core of your game is the fundamental pillar of your experience while playing it. A good example of this is the first Super Mario games. If you strip everything from those games, you will notice that running, jumping, and falling are at the core of the gameplay mechanics of the franchise. If those three mechanics would have been done differently, those games wouldn't feel or even function the same way. But that begs the question, what is the dinosaur survival genre's minimal viable product? To find the answer, we need to analyze the games within it and discover the pattern. What does The Isle, Beast of Bermuda, Path of Titans, Animalia, Isles of Yore, and Draconia have in common? You start the game with a very small and vulnerable version of a specific character that slowly grows in power over time or upon completing objectives. You are thrown in a world where other players like you compete for survival and resources. Your character has requirements like food or water. you can die from multiple sources. More often than not, even reproduce, and your main goal is to stay alive for as long as possible. This is almost the exact same process all living organisms experience in real life: birth, growth, reproduction, and death. The dinosaur, or animal actually, survival genre takes the survival aspect and turns it into its purest form. These games are essentially life simulators, a social experience where players interact with the world and each other in order to survive and thrive. So to keep things simple, these are the fundamental pillars that all these games have: movement for traversal, growth, increasing in power and capabilities throughout the player's journey, sustainability, constant requirements to be met by the player, combat, the most direct form of interaction between players that also serves as a tool for sustainability, and nesting, a soft end goal for players. This is the core of this genre. Every single game mentioned previously has its own flavor on every single one of these five aspects, and that's what makes them unique around each other. But does this formula work? That is hard to say. These games only started appearing less than a decade ago, and most of them are less than 5 years old, so the entire concept of the genre as a whole, it's very young in comparison to the industry standards. On top of that, even though dinosaurs are very popular in pop culture, dinosaur games are not, and that is reflected in the gaming industry as a whole. Every 1 to 2 years, we see trends come and go. A game becomes really popular, becomes mainstream, clones and copycats appear left and right for about 3 years, the market gets saturated, people get bored, people stop playing said games, the trend dies, another game gets popular, and the cycle continues. This happens because due to the massive popularity of a specific game or a specific genre, AAA and indie companies alike try to capitalize from the heavy influx of players on said game. We have seen that with Minecraft, DayZ, and most recently, Fortnite. But the opposite can also occur. If the population of a game or genre is very low, there's little to no incentive to make similar products. It would be a waste of time and resources making something that has a high risk of failure. Dinosaur games are a niche genre. The player base is very dedicated, but is also really small. And with so few potential consumers, companies don't have really financial motivation or reason really to create one. But money is not everything, and several people put blood, sweat, and tears out of pure passion to create these fantastic games, and their relative success even during early access proves that this genre has potential. And you can see that already. For the past 2 years, numerous titles have been released, announced, or in early development. There is clearly some attention being built in regards to animal survival games. However, there's still a lot to be done. All these games, especially the big three, are far from perfect, and the player retention is extremely low for many reasons, but there are a few that are especially important to improve the player's experience. What are these games' issues exactly, besides, you know, performance and lack of content? Poor player introduction, self-insufficiency, and excess of that screen time. Many titles of this genre do not possess tutorials or even tooltips to guide players that engage with the game for the first time. People being thrown into a multiplayer server with zero information of its mechanics will very easily feel overwhelmed, confused, and more likely to abandon it before they have the gameplay experience the developers intended. The initial impression of a game is extremely important for newcomers. The beginning of your game is the only part that 100% of the player base interacts with, so you should start your game the best way possible by slowly and accumulatively introducing the main game mechanics and let the player experiment with them. Only Path of Titans possesses a tutorial, teaching players the basics of the game while skipping part of the growth process as a reward. Despite not being immersive, the tutorial is functional and serves its purpose well enough. Always online multiplayer games like competitive, MMOs, and survival games thrive through player interaction. In those games, the majority, if not all, the content are tools for people to use with or against each other. But that exact aspect that attracts so many people has a very serious issue that the developers must keep a close eye on. When a great portion of the content is based around other players or straight up requires them to function, if the player base starts to decline for whatever reason, that can doom the entire game in a scarily fast amount of time. Every game loses players over time. It's an inevitable phenomenon that all of them experience at some point. It can be for content drought, heavily unbalanced patches, controversial content updates, or simply better titles appearing over the months or years. However, games that rely on the players to be the content suffer much more from this. In a single player, since there are no external requirements to play it, a person can buy it, hop on, and experience it fully even after a decade has passed and there's no one playing it. The same cannot be said for games like The Isle. Players can only experience the entire game if other people are also playing in the same instance. And we are not talking about one, two, or three extra people, we are talking about dozens of them. With such heavy maintenance, if these games' population decline, the community that remains will have less and less members to play with. And if it gets bad enough, it will be literally impossible for them to play the game at all. And this is even worse if people notice it. In case the community sees that the player count is in a decline or it's very low in general, there's a very high chance that they will consider switching games and come back once the game gets more content, if they come back at all. But if people start migrating to other titles, the decline gets sharper, and the population gets even smaller. If the population gets even smaller, people will start having issues playing the game. If people start having issues playing the game, they will notice people are leaving, and if they notice that people are leaving, they will get even more incentive to leave as well. This very easily can turn into an exodus spiral that leaves the game completely barren. At that moment, the game is in life support, and the developers need to solve it very quickly in order to save it. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But this time frame is crucial. The longer they take to fix the issue, the more invested players will get into other games, which at that point it will be very difficult converting them back. Dead screen time is a phenomenon in media represented by a period of time when the pacing slows down drastically. In video games, this happens when the player starts having less activities to complete, or lesser, less demanding tasks to perform. In this genre specifically, dead screen time is extremely prevalent. For the majority of titles, growing, one of the core pillars of their gameplay experience, is completed by simply waiting, and the amount of time they need to reach maximum size is ridiculously long. 2, 4, 6, sometimes even 8 hours. That's a ridiculous amount of time. And on top of that, most of them don't have many mechanics to play with, so most of the time players spend the majority of the growth period AFK growing, which basically means staying away from the game, coming back every so often to meet the animal's requirements, go away again, repeating the process until they reach maximum growth. But even after that time period, players spend a huge portion of their playthrough walking between areas in hopes to find other people, or simply stay in the same spot waiting for other players to appear. This situation is even worse for herbivores. Since they do not require other players to stay alive, outside of combat, the amount of activities is extremely limited, non-existent in some cases even. Some games try to fix this issue by adding adjacent mechanics to growth to keep players busy while rewarding them with faster growing speed or stat bonuses. The problem is that their execution now forces the player to perform boring, non-engaging tasks that must be completed, otherwise they will be penalized for it. So now, instead of not being able to do anything, players are tied to uninteresting chores. You tell me which one is worse. So now that we know the major problems that these games face, how can they be solved? This genre tries to deliver a very specific experience, and for players to understand that, a good tutorial must be in place. One that not only presents the player with the fundamental mechanics, but also allows them to experiment said mechanics and lets them explore their synergy between each other. For people to be able to enjoy these titles at any time without external factors, a significant portion of their content must be dedicated, or at least function, on its own. To achieve this, features would have to be made in order to add extra activities or challenges that don't require other players to perform. AI creatures for carnivore players to hunt, dynamic world events that add temporary adversity so players are still in danger even in cases where the population is down, external forces that specifically target players like AI tribes, plagues, zombies, aliens, anything really, as long as there's consistency. By doing this, not only the game would have evergreen content that doesn't require population to be done, it also adds extra activities that would make the growth process much more engaging without the need of forcing players to perform tedious tasks. Now, some of you may say that this is just adding content, and while you are technically correct, this specific kind of content is deliberate. Its main purpose is to not require people to exist as a way to keep people engaged in the game and prevent mass exodus from happening. But what would you do? What ideas do you think would be interesting to add? Let me know in the comments below. A huge thank you to my Patreon supporters for supporting the channel and the content I create. If you want to join the ranks, the link will be in the description. Join our Discord server for memes and paleo nut stuff, and hope to see you next week.